Jesus. Well, why don't you come up to the front? We're going to go after the Lord tonight. Thank Him for this amazing grace that He's given to us. Hallelujah. We bless You, Lord. We give You tonight. We ask that You would have Your way in us, that You would teach us, that You would bring us higher tonight, deeper in You, Lord. We give You our ears, our eyes, our hearts, our minds. Lord, speak to us tonight. Speak to us tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That You would take my place. That You would bear my cross. You would lay down Your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that You've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That You would take my place. That You would bear my cross. You would lay down Your life. That I would be set free. I sing for all that You've done for me. Oh, You've done for me. Oh, You've done for me, Lord. Oh, I'm singing about You, Lord. Sing words. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That You would take my place. That You would bear my cross. You would lay down Your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that You've done for me. Oh,
The dead are raised, the sin should this life bring suffering, Lord, I will remember what Calvary has bought for me, both now and forever.
Amazed in your love.
and I will sing of your goodness forevermore. Worthy is your name, Jesus, and you deserve the praise. And worthy is your name, and worthy is your name. As your glory fills this place, you alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens. As your glory fills this place, you alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens. As your glory you alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens. As your glory fills this place, you alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens. As your glory
casual Jesus. It's powerful Jesus. It holds authority. It gets the job done, so to speak. The demons tremble at your name. every knee will bow at your name. Jesus. Your name changes the atmosphere. Just the confession of your name brings the sinner into right relationship with you. We honor you today. You are truly worthy of this time, of this worship, of this gathering together where we come to honor you and magnify you. And we boast about you and how good you are. As we lift up our hands in surrender, Holy Spirit, have your way in our service, in the youth group, the children's church. Have your way. We love you and we honor you and we thank you for your name. In Jesus' name, and all the believers said, amen. Praise the Lord. Well, youth, we will release you. Children, we will release you. Everyone else can scoot in closer. We have childcare for all ages. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Just a few announcements. We have our Bible study this Sunday. Say this Sunday's Bible study. I love our Bible study time. So encourage you to come. I think people enjoy it also because they come. 6 p.m. Then Palm Sunday is not this Sunday, but next Sunday. That's coming up pretty quick. And so we have a bucket in the back if you can donate Easter candy. We're going to pack them next Wednesday, so if you bring them to me next Sunday, this Sunday's good, next Wednesday's good, but the Sunday of the event, I'm not packing them. They'll already be done. So if we can get candy here before them. And I have a sign-up sheet in the back if you want to bring dessert or hamburger or hot dog buns. The church will provide the rest. We're just asking for those donations. We're going to meet at 4:30. We're going to eat around 5:30. So if you have family, friends, someone coming with kids for the Easter egg hunt, it's up to age 12. We're doing it at 5 p.m. So try to make sure people are there, their kids are there before then. Bring your lawn chair, picnic blankets, and we're going to have a wonderful time. Games and fun. Invite somebody. And so we will meet here that morning. We are having service that morning at 10:30, and then we'll meet that afternoon. We have the offering baskets out. Oh, I forgot to tell the youth. I think they might already put some if they wanted to. Vote who gets pied in the face. We still have that going on. That's going to be fun. That'll be the last Wednesday of the month, March 27th. We might all get pied in the face. Thank you, Jesus. If you have any kids in children's care, get them right after the service. All right, let's just like shake the distractions off. We need to shake off some distractions. I could feel it during worship. Lord, have your way in this service. Have your way, even if it's not a lot of people tonight. I know people out for many different reasons. They wrote us, but that's okay. Remember that Jesus is here. So just shake off the day, take a deep breath, let it out, and let's come with our faith tonight. Amen? How many of you enjoyed Pastor Nick on Sunday? I enjoy him. I was telling you, he doesn't get loud. He actually got loud a little bit. I was like, well, he got loud. I didn't know he got loud like that. And he is funny. I didn't know he had a sense of humor like that. So that was good. I so enjoyed that. I enjoyed the moving of the Holy Spirit. You know, there's a place for the Word, absolutely. And then there's a place for the Holy Spirit to move, absolutely. You have to have both. Because if you have all Word and no Spirit, you dry up. If you have all Spirit and no Word, you blow up. That's where you get kooky. That's where someone was asking us if we handle snakes. Again, recently, someone was talking about the snakes. I'm like, no, that's kooky. That's when you have, we're just moving with the Spirit, which is good, but when it gets outside of this, so all Word, no Spirit, you dry up. All Spirit, no Word, you blow up, but when you mix the Word and the Spirit, you go up. And so I love the moving of the Holy Spirit. I love when the altar calls are full and people are getting touched by God. I've seen the hunger and the growth in this church in that area of allowing the Holy Spirit to move from when we first started here. I remember when the first time Pastor Butch came, of course, not many people knew him, but he had to work hard for that altar call for people to come up. And yeah, people here don't know Pastor Nick, and people responded very quickly because there's been a hunger. We've been preaching. We've been exposing y'all to revival, the fire of God. You're digging. You're sowing seeds. And I see that now there is such, and Pastor Nick said, I think it's the second easiest place, he said, to minister. Is that correct? As far as the level of hunger and the moving of the Holy Spirit in the room. So that was very encouraging to hear. I could feel people's hunger. You can feel when there's resistance in the room. You can feel when people are distracted. You can feel when they're hungry. And I felt people Sunday were very hungry, and that's a very good thing. So we love preaching the word. We love preaching the foundational messages. We need the practical, how to run family, finances, what's going on. We need that. But we can't neglect also the prophetic flow. We can't neglect the gifts of the Holy Spirit. There are 9 gifts of the Holy Spirit. That's not what I'm teaching on tonight. I'm just flowing right now as I feel led. I might get to my message. I might not. But there are 9 gifts, and I bet most Christians don't even know what those gifts are. And if you don't know where they are, how can we ask for them to operate in them? They're to help us and to equip us. And so you got word of knowledge, word of wisdom, prophecy, gifts of healings, working of miracles, the gift of faith, discerning of spirits, diverse tongues, and tongues with interpretation. That's your 9 gifts of the Holy Spirit. And I'm not going to ask you, but I said show your hands if you knew that. A lot of people don't. How can you, and that's in 2nd, where's it at? 1st or 2nd Corinthians? And so how can you ask God to flow? Because it's as the Spirit wills. So it can come upon you, prophecy. It can come upon you, word of knowledge, where you can help people. There was a minister, and he, what's his name? Rick Renner. Rick Renner is a powerful man. He's been in Russia for I don't know how many years. He was just ministering at Rodney's church and Andrew Womack's church. And there was a woman dying of, it might have been cancer. And they were all praying over her for a healing, but by word of knowledge, he knew the source. Because sometimes when you're praying for someone to get healed, it's actually rooted in something demonic. And you need those gifts of the Holy Spirit to be in operation to show you. And what happened was the Lord showed him, because the Lord, when he walked in the room, a lot of ministers had been praying for this woman, and she wasn't getting healed. She believed for healing. And when he walked in the room, the Holy Spirit said, when you pray for her, she's going to get healed. And he was like, oh, I'm the man of God. I'm going to get this woman healed, you know, feeling a little pride. He said, I want you to go lay on top of her. And he was like, wait, what? And he sat in the room for a long time. I'm not doing that. And Holy Spirit said, if you don't do it, she will not be healed. And he laid on top of her. I know that sounds weird. She was like on a chair and like laid over her, and she was in pain. And then the Holy Spirit said that this woman has dealt with rejection from the time she was a child until she's older. It's a spirit of rejection that has manifested as cancer in her body. It's killing her. So when he called it out, she got set free and got instantly healed. We need the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Don't think they're kooky. So you got to study them. And you got to know where they are so you can ask God. You can't force that. I can't come up here and say, God, I want word of knowledge and I'm going to do it. Like, no, you got to, that can get kooky. You got to wait for the Holy Spirit to show you. Tongues with interpretation. That's a powerful tool. You're praying in tongues. Ask the Lord. When you're praying in tongues, if you don't pray in tongues daily, you need to. Ask the Lord, what am I praying? Show me. Don't neglect the moving of the Holy Spirit and the gifts. Those are tools given to the church. And they're not taught about because I think people have seen the abuse or the misuse of them, but we can't throw that away. Right. We've seen people come to this church, get saved, fire on fire for God, and they're not here today. So do we stop preaching salvation? I preach healing. Has everyone got a healing manifest in their body? Not yet. Am I going to stop preaching healing? We laid hands on people to get filled with the Holy Spirit and pray in tongues, and not everyone received. The Holy Spirit's ready. Sometimes people don't receive because they're stuck here. Do we just stop preaching on those things? So do we throw away all the spiritual gifts, a powerful tool given to us because someone got a little kooky with it? No, we don't. So we need the word and we need the moving of the Spirit. Word of knowledge, word of wisdom, discerning of spirits. You need that. You'll discern somebody. You'll pick up real quick, are they of God or they're not? That's probably one of the gifts operating the most. I just don't call it out, tell people, because it's my own personal use. Not my own personal use. God shows me things, and it's protected us, and it's also shown me how to pray for people, and also it's kept us safe from certain relationships. It's and also there's people that I will trust because the Lord showed me that they were trustworthy. And that I did not ask for when I was a new believer. It's just something that was upon me. The Lord gives them as he wills. I'm flowing tonight. Are you ready to flow? I had listened to this. We had tried to play it probably 4 or 5 months ago with Adonica, Howard Brown singing in tongues. Were y'all here? They were in Budapest many years ago, and they were having a revival service, and you hear people screaming in the background, the fire of God. There again, that's a moving of the Holy Spirit. People scream under the fire of God, and people think that's weird, and they get scared. I'm like, it's just God touching them. It's so powerful, they can't contain it. And she goes off singing in tongues. I cannot find the full service. I have tried to find it. I can't, but he was in, oh gosh, they were young, so this must have been sometime in the 90s. And she's singing in tongues. This is one of the, it's a gift. And I don't know the interpretation for it, but I know it in my spirit. It's the Father singing a love song over the children. I don't know the words. The Lord hasn't given me the words. I'm just going to play it. I'm going to flow tonight. This has nothing to do with my message. I'm just flowing tonight. Can we flow? Yeah. A few of us? Okay. The rest of you just along for the ride. That's beautiful. That is anointed. Amen. I will put that on sometimes and just let it play over and over. It's a short. I don't know how to find the full version of it. I don't know if someone interpreted it or not, but I just play it over and just releases the anointing in the atmosphere. I had a shower the other day. I had my little speaker Bluetooth and it was blaring. I was like, one of the kids might come fussing, but they ain't touching my speaker. I'll give you my phone. That is so beautiful. You can look it up. Adonica Howard Brown singing in tongues. Let the anointing flow in your home. That's the manifest presence of the Holy Spirit, the anointing. You know, you can't hear the truth and stay neutral. You got to pick a side. I want to choose the side of faith. I want to choose this truth. So we need to mix faith with everything that we hear from the Word of God. Don't mix faith with stuff outside of that. Don't mix faith with human reasoning. Don't mix faith with the news. Mix faith with this. You know, Timothy was a disciple of Paul. And Paul told him, he said in 1 Timothy 6, he said, fight the good fight of faith. You know why? Because to stay in faith, it's a fight. Everything in this world tries to pull you into unbelief, which will stop the flow and the power of God from moving in your life. Discouragement, doubt, fear. Fight the good fight of faith. Fight it. Hold on to it. Don't let it go. In Hebrews 4, it says, for indeed the gospel was preached to us as well as to them, but the word which they heard did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in those who heard it. You can read this and it can do nothing for you. You can come to these kind of services where we teach victory, we teach about the gifts of the Holy Spirit, we do altar calls, we do everything we can to get people to live in victory, and you can stay exactly where you are in life if you don't mix faith with what's taking place. That's why we say, shake off the distractions. Bring your faith. That's why we have altar calls. Mix your faith in what's taking place. Or you just stay the same. Fight the good fight of faith. So did you bring your faith tonight? Yeah. I brought mine. Father, we ask that you help us to see with your eyes tonight. Think through our minds that we may hear the word that's going to be spoken tonight. That we have listening ears and our hearts are open and receptive to your holy word. We thank you, Father, that lives are being changed in this church because we mix our faith with the Word of God. We thank you for it, Father, in Jesus' name. Tonight, our key text is John 11, 43 to 44. Now, when he had said these things, he cried with a loud voice. Now, remember, Lazarus has died. He's been in the tomb 4 days. They said he was probably stinking. Leave it alone. It's too far gone. It's looking bad in the natural. But we know Jesus was a faith preacher. Jesus didn't go by sense knowledge. He went by what the Father showed him. And so with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. He spoke out his faith. And he who had died came out bound hand and foot with grave clothes. And his face was wrapped with a cloth. Listen to what Jesus said. Jesus said to them, to the disciples, to those watching. He didn't say it to himself, I'm going to go and set him free. He said, hey, loose him. You loose him and let him go. Underline that in your Bible. And Jesus said to them, loose him and let him go. You do it. Jesus did his part. He raised him from the dead. This is a picture of someone who's in spiritual death. Brought to spiritual life. Born again believer. Bound up. Alive in Christ, but bound up. Not walking in the freedom that Jesus paid for. Their hands are bound and they still have the grave clothes on. It's actually a picture of hopelessness and sadness. But Jesus said, loose them and let them go. So that tells me, loose him. It's Jesus' will that we walk in freedom. He gave a command. He's saying he's bound. He's in grave clothes. But I need you to do something about it. It is an honor, a privilege, a right of the children of God to preach the word to others and see them set free. We teach healing. We teach salvation. The baptism of the Holy Spirit. The small groups, how to handle your finances, how to handle marriage, how to handle your children. We are wanting to loose people and let them go. Because there are plenty of believers walking around bound up. And if we don't do our part, they're going to stay bound. Because sometimes people need help. Can you say amen? Amen. Do sometimes people need you to come alongside them and say, hey, let's not do that. There's freedom. There's victory. This is how you should handle your marriage. This is how you should spank your children. This is how you should handle your job. Hey, you need healing in your body? This is the way. Loose them and let them go. That is an honor. And look, and I say this because we're all called to do it. It's not just for us who are behind here. It's a short time in the week. There's people you know, people you're related to, people you work with, I'll never see. And Jesus is telling you and he's telling me, hey, go loose them and let them go. And so we're going to look at some scriptures tonight on freedom. Can we go there tonight? We're going to look at the word loose from other scriptures because I want to paint a picture to you. It is God's will for us to walk in liberty. It is God's will for us to walk in freedom and victory. You know, I was thinking about this the other day. I can preach healing. We can preach all these things. But if you don't realize that God really wants it for you personally and that he really loves you and has compassion for you, you'll never really get it to manifest in your own life, whether that's finances, healing, freedom, addiction from addictions, because you're always in doubt. It's like it's for everyone else, but it's not for me. Jesus, he didn't pick and choose. You had faith, it's yours. Loose them and let them go. Genesis 49, 21. Naphtali is a deer. This is one of the sons of Jacob. What a name, Naphtali. Naphtali is a deer. Let loose. He was speaking this over his. He had the 12 sons, and when he was dying, he was speaking a word. And he said, Naphtali is a deer let loose. He uses beautiful words. He is a deer let loose. You ever see a deer let loose? They are bouncing and running and leaping, and they are full of life. That's a picture of what we're supposed to be like. When I was a park ranger, I would make my rounds in my truck, and I was going to the East Landing, and it's a heavy wooded area. It kind of reminds me of North Louisiana down south. And I remember this huge buck comes running from a levee and jumping and leaped. I can't tell you how high over a barbed wire fence, and was so full of life. And when I read that, that's the picture that came to my mind. That's how believers are supposed to be, full of life, full of joy, like the deer let loose. My pages are stuck. We're not to go through life defeated and miserable. Do things happen? But you know what? Even when you go through things, you can still have joy. You know, peace and joy, it's not the absence of conflict or problems. It's just what's your faith in? What are you trusting? The situation or God? And I know that can seem hard to say because we go through things. I understand the storms of life come. But, you know, I was thinking about Dodie Osteen. I've shared her testimony so many times when she got that diagnosis, December 10th, 1981, that she had 3 weeks to live from cancer. You know, of course, they went home. They spoke their faith. They cursed it through. They commanded to leave. She got her healing scriptures out. I mean, she stood on the word. Well, December 10th, Christmas is 15 days later. You know, Christmas Eve, she had people over from the church and served coffee and cookies, looking like she was dying. And she opened up the door and smiled and greeted people. She was jaundiced. She was weighing 89 pounds. Her body was literally dying. But she wasn't going to let that stop her. She didn't let the situation dictate to her what she should do. They said she was acting healed, even though we could tell physically she wasn't, but she was believing it was already hers. And y'all know the story. I mean, she just turned 90. She lived. To be full of life, to be full of joy, no matter what. I mean, how are we going to set people free if we're like, hey, I'm on my fifth divorce. I kicked the dog this morning. I disowned my aunt and uncle, and I don't talk to my sister anymore. And, you know, but hey, Jesus loves you. Let's go, come to church with me. No, we need to be set free first. And I'm not saying your life has to be perfect, but you know what I mean. Let's get let loose, if I could say it like that, so we can help others. Amen. Galatians 5:13, for you, brethren, have been called to liberty. That's freedom. Only do not use liberty as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. Whom the Son has set free is free indeed. That word indeed means he has really set us free. So you can tell in this verse, he wants people. You have been called to liberty. And then it enables you to love and serve one another so you can help people. I'm just challenging us tonight. This is for the church. This is a message for the church. To help one another. Don't see people. I think sometimes when people get, you know, they get first saved, they look messy still. And that's okay, because they are. Remember, their spirit's born again, but that flesh and that soulless realm have to grow, and the spirit realm has to begin to dominate. So we can't look at people and start to judge them and think they're hopeless. We need to love them and help them and reach out to them and set them free of whatever it is they're struggling with. I'm so thankful you didn't see me in the flesh. We need to see people as God sees them. We need to see people as God sees them, and I know that's hard. I know that's hard to do, but we really need to look at people with the eyes of Jesus. I mean, I think about my testimony. I mean, I was bulimic. I was a cutter. I would smoke cigarettes all the time. I'd say the F word all the time. You could have gave up on me. Like, you really could have ran, and I wouldn't have blamed you. Of course, you were backslidden and had your own problems, too, so we're kind of in a mess together. We were in a whittle mess together. And then we started going to church. And it looked messy with that too. I'm sure I didn't wear the right clothes and I didn't say the right things and I smoked my cigarettes in the parking lot. I saw someone get here the other day and they're smoking their cigarettes. Hey, that was like me, like 20 years ago. But I wasn't a hopeless case. I need people to love me and to take off the bondage, take off the grave clothes. And that came, one, someone has to be willing. You can't force it on somebody. So I had to do my part. I had to show up at church. I had to read the Word of God, and I had to listen to that preacher. So they need to do their part. I'm not saying chase people around who are not wanting it. But when we see people, reach out to them, get their number, call them, invite them to all those crazy volleyball games y'all do. Bring them to the Bible study. Because Jesus said, let them go, let them loose, set them free. Amen? Isaiah 58, 6 through 7. Is this not the fast that I have chosen? To loose the bonds of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, to let the oppressed go free, and that you break every yoke. Notice the expressions, to loose, to undo, to let free, and to break. I'm telling you, there is so much power in you, the authority that's given to you in the name of Jesus. When you speak life, I think people just discredit themselves. We've only been saved 6 months. Well, if you got a testimony about Jesus, you got something to share. Or they see themselves not valuable. Or maybe they're worried what other people will think. But Jesus said, loose them and let them go. Who's going to do that? If y'all think it's just Jeremy and I, we're limited then. But we've got a whole church full of people. I'm telling you, if you've been sitting here for 6 months under the teachings we teach and taking the Word of God and reading it, I'm telling you, are very qualified. Right. You have something to share. Yeah. Loose them and let them go. Jeremiah 40, verse 4. And now behold, I loose thee this day from the chains which were upon thy hand. This is a captain of the guard. The Israelites did not listen to the Lord as they were supposed to, and they're being exiled into Babylon. And the captain of the guard looks for Jeremiah, finds Jeremiah bound up, and he tells him, you can come over to Babylon, the enemy's territory, or he says, you can be free and go where you want. And if you want to tell that to people today, you know the Lord, why do you want to keep going back to the enemy's territory? What does it have for you? Or you can walk in freedom. Be loosed and let him go. Psalm 16, 16 through 18. O Lord, truly I am thy servant and the son of thy handmaid. Thou hast loosed my bonds. I will offer to thee a sacrifice of thanksgiving and will call upon the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows unto the Lord now in the presence of all his people. He says he's loosed the bonds. You offer the sacrifice of thanksgiving. I think about Paul and Silas when they were in jail and they had been beaten because they set a little girl free of a demon and they were in the stocks and they sing praises to God at midnight. In the dark hour, in the midnight hour, they're singing praises to God. Were they free in that moment? Not in the natural. They were free in here though. And then we know the place was shaken, everything came off and they got free. Don't underestimate being thankful to God. I'm telling you, if you just have to sit in your living room and thank God for the clean water you drink, start there. It blesses the Lord. Thank God that you were saved. Thank God that you have a job. I get frustrated when people complain about their job. It's like, then go find something you really want to do, or just be quiet and thank God it pays your bills. God hates laziness. I wasn't raised to be lazy. Daddy didn't play that game. He'd cut grass. Let me go on a little side trail here. Daddy would cut grass, and we didn't have a blower. I don't even know if they had blowers back then. And we had a long driveway. And when you were a kid, that driveway seemed really long. And he'd cut that grass all over that driveway. And you know you could turn the lawnmower around, just put that blade on, it'd blow it right back off. Daddy wouldn't do that. He'd say, go get the broom and sweep it. And I didn't give no lip. Now in here some stuff was going on, but you said yes, sir, to Daddy. And then I'd Windex. We had a glass on our coffee table. Get the corners, Danielle. Yes, sir. Be thankful to the Lord. If you have a strong body that can work and move and bend and do stuff, thank God for that. Thank God for that. You know, sometimes you feel like, I don't want to go do the dishes. Then I tell myself, no, I'm so thankful I can stand and do these dishes. Meet someone in a wheelchair who's dying in their bed, they'd be happy to get up and go wash some dishes. I don't want to clean the house. I know I have those thoughts too, but I'm telling you, I'll replace those thoughts with, I'm so happy I'm alive and I get to take care of my family. Be thankful to God. It will set you free from depressed thoughts. It will set you free from negative thoughts. We don't do negativity in our house. I do not like negative, critical talk. At times we need to be real and talk about things, and even people in church, we have to be real and talk about things. But you know when someone crosses over to negativity, and they're constantly like that. It's like, okay, well, let's be thankful for something. Yeah. It blesses the Lord to be thankful because he wants you free. He paid a high price for you and me to be free. I was thinking about Hannah. At the end of the service, Miss Jenny was praying for her. She called it foyer ministry, lobby ministry. And she said, because she don't know Hannah's story. She'd never met Hannah before. But you know Hannah's story, that she had an abusive relationship and she held into bitterness. And when Pastor Butch came and prayed for her, the joy hit her and she's been joyful ever since. So he called her Long Joy because she's long and she had joy. And Miss Jenny looked at her and said, you know, like when you eat a lot of garlic and it comes out through your pores, you can smell it. She said, that's how you are with joy. What a way to. And she said, you have so much joy. It just seeps out of you because she's thankful to the Lord. The Lord has loosed her bonds. When you are free, you can tell when people are free. When you see people for worship and they all. Stretching, yawning. You know what? I really want to go thump them on the head, but we can't. I was just listening to our neighbors talk about the missionaries in Romania, how so long ago it was communist, and their church, Sweetwater Baptist, sends missionaries out. They do a mission trip every year, and some of the older generation talked about how when it was heavy communist, that when you went to church, you went expecting you might die. And we have all this freedom. Now, I know tonight, whoever's watching who missed tonight, I know several people had several things going on. I know why they missed, but I'm talking about when a church is just, I'll just show up if I want to. In fact, church has to fit into my schedule. And if it works out, it works out. No. No, 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 no. You work church in first. I'm sorry. That's the way I was even raised like that, and we weren't even saved. We went to church. It's just so flippant, church, if I have time. If it's not raining. If it rains, I ain't going. Mm-mm. Cold weather, I'm not going. When you go to certain places of the world, they walk miles. Where we were in Cambodia, they sit in the dirt. It's hot. Very hot. Like very, very hot. I like hot, but that's like a whole other level hot. And they come with such joy. And we're just so, church. Praise the Lord. I'm so thankful that we have freedoms right now to be in church. I wonder how many Bibles we even have in our house. About 25 Bibles. I'm so thankful for my Bible. How many people read a Bible every day, pick it up and read it? Oh, we better be thankful we have this. One day they might come for them. I don't know what I'd do if someone came for my Bible. I don't know. I think I would probably lose my life. Yeah. I really just don't know if someone came to take the Word of God from me. I know it's in here, but like Pastor Nick said, it was spoken to be written down, so it's written down so it can be spoken and preached. I don't know what I would do. I mean, if you just sit there and just thank God for a Bible, well, thank God for that. There's freedom. Loose him and let him go. It's all in here. Matthew 18:18. Assuredly, Jesus is telling, I tell you the truth. I say to you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. This is referring, if you read that chapter, it's church action that's taken place. Bind up things that are not for you. I bind up depressing thoughts. I bind up sickness and pain. I command it to leave my body. I loose healing, salvation. I loose joy, freedom, free from addictions. I'm in victory. You know, we have these altar calls, and it's a point of contact where people can come and release their faith and receive. Because we want to loose them and let them go. But when you get touched, it's how you're going to walk it out when you get out there. That's where the battle is, huh? It's easy in an atmosphere of faith and the anointing and the preacher, the guest preacher's here. And I'm not, I love it. I love it. Let God touch you. But when you get out there, carry that. Stay free. Don't go back to bondage. Luke 13:12. When Jesus saw her, he called her to him and said to her, "Woman, you are loosed from your infirmity." Jesus was in the synagogue, and this woman had been bound up 18 years. She was bent over. She might have had some form of scoliosis, arthritis. She had a messed up back for 18 years. And Jesus tells her, woman, you are loosed from your infirmity. You know, Jesus was a faith man and a faith preacher. And when people asked us, are you one of those faith preachers? You just want to say, can we just be real tonight? It's not many of us. You just want to say in the natural, now you can't because you got to be very professional, but you just want to say, hey, doofus, did you read about Jesus? When he told that woman she was loosed, she was still bent over when he said it. He was calling things that were not as though they were. He was speaking faith. He didn't see it. She was bent over. He's telling her she's loosed. He's telling her she's free, but she's bent over. Jesus was a faith preacher. He was doing positive confessions. He was speaking the word of God. I don't believe in all that. Then you knock on Jesus. That's what you want to tell them. But you just say, yes, I am a faith preacher. I am. You can't get saved without faith. You can't get healed without faith. You can't please God without faith. You're not going to get baptized in the Holy Spirit without faith. Your finances are not going to increase without faith. So, yeah, faith preachers. Faith Bible. He's a faith God. He spoke things into existence before he physically saw them. Well, I don't believe that naming it and claiming it. Well, then you don't believe Jesus. Well, I don't believe in calling things that are not as though they... Well, you don't believe in Jesus. He did it. God did it. So I'm going to do it. Amen. Getting me worked up. I was very calm until that point. Jesus spoke. He loosed faith. And you know what happened to that woman? She's bent over. He's telling her she's free. She's still bent over. And I know the crowd. You know you got the haters looking. Look what he's saying. She's free. And she's not really free. Look at her. Oh, but Jesus went and touched her, and then she stood up straight. He spoke it first, then he did it. I can go to a whole healing testimony. Well, let me tell you a healing testimony about my cat. Let's just have fun tonight. I have two beautiful cats. They are beautiful. And my Adora was dropped off at her house. She was 4 months old, about, and it was December 20th, 2021. I need to write those dates down so I'm going to forget. And, of course, Vivian cried, and our other cat was in Cambodia, and we kept her. She had been, I think someone tried to rip out her claw. She was bloody. I don't know how she got to my house. I guess someone dropped her off. It was a freezing cold day. And I was backing up to go to Walmart, and I saw her run to our door, and she wanted to come inside. So she was an inside cat. In fact, she wouldn't use the bathroom for 24 hours, so I bought a litter box. You should have seen Jeremy's face. You bought a litter box and litter? Well, she hadn't gone to the bathroom yet. I promise you I'm finding a home for her. Now he knows my thing. Like, he's like, once they bring it in the house, it ain't leaving. And anyway, she used the litter box right away. So someone had her. So we have her, and she's beautiful. If y'all met her, she's friendly. She flirts with everybody. My cats are needy. I'm like, y'all are not dogs. They're not. And so then, of course, May 15th last year, Jeremy sits me down, and he's like, I need to talk to you and Vivian right now. And I'm like, very serious. He's not a very serious person, but he was very firm. And so I sat in his office at home, and Vivian was doing something. I was like, what? Danielle, I do not want another cat. And I said, okay. And I'm looking at a door, and I'm thinking, she must have done something wrong, but she's not a bad cat. Danielle, I'm telling you, I do not want another cat. And I said, I understand that. I'm not asking you for another cat. I mean, I am confused. And I'm thinking, did the cat? He said, Danielle, listen to me. I'm telling you, Danielle, I do not want another cat. And I'm like, yes, sir. What else do I have to do? And he said, go look at the rose bush outside. Now we got quite a few, so we went to the wrong one, me and Vivian, because she came in at that point. And so we were like, what rose bush? He said, the one by that front fence. And there sitting, little four-week-old starving kitten, my little Nala. She's black and white. She has a little white, like a little tuxedo. She's my little, call her my little black girl. I love her. And so she was sitting there real cute, and we picked her up, and she was so tiny, and I showed the neighbor, and they couldn't keep her because they have dogs, and they would kill it, and I knew, asked if she would know anyone, and I brought it to Walmart, I brought it to the kid's school, and then a week goes by, and Vivian's done mothering it for a week at that point. What you do when your daughter's crying? So we kept the cat. I got the cat. I spoke faith. What she said? It was a God wink. Yeah, even my neighbor, she said, God delivered, the stork brought that little baby for us. And she was starving, and the two get along, and they're so cute together. So me and Vivian love our cats. But after a short time of having her, she'd break out with like these hives in her neck. And they would kind of like break and bleed when she'd scratch them. And I was praying over her. And I was thinking, Jeremy, let me take that cat to the vet. I'm ready feeding an extra cat. I got litter for an extra cat. I got to buy flea medicine for the cat. I'm like, I don't want to ask him to go to the vet with the cat. And so, because we are faith preachers and we call things that are not as though they are, you know, casually just, and they would kind of go away, but they'd come back. And I mean, not fully go away. And so about 3 weeks ago, I got serious. I laid hands on my cat. I rebuked those things. I cursed them at the root. I told them to get off my cat. And listen, I read last week, we have dominion over the animals. I read to you that scripture. So God does heal animals. He will heal your animal. And so I said, God, thank you. My cat is healed. She's healed from all bumps and allergies and sores and scratches. Every day I laid hands on her and said, thank you, God, because I already spoke my faith. I already rebuked it. I call things not as though they were. And every day I lay hands on her. Well, this week, you know what? She has none and they haven't come back. So my kitty got healed. God loves my cats. He gave them to us to take delight in. Call it. I will not get an amen on that one. Y'all pray for Jeremy. He's very patient with me. However, I will not get any other animals because it's a lot of fur. It's the fur and the litter. No, it's not coming to my house. People have found them. They're not. In fact, some other ones showed up recently that were wild, and I threw a little food out, and he said, you stop that now. He was clear. He didn't use eyebrows that time. He was very clear. He said, because we're going to have 20 cats. And then he said to Paul, and Paul said the same thing. Y'all going to have 20 cats. I was like, don't, Paul. He reinforced him. So I said, okay, I will listen. And one got run over, got killed. So you're right, I cannot rescue everything, but I got my two cats and I love. But anyway, that's a healing testimony because we are faith people, and I prayed over my animal, and I declared it was healed, and I thank the Lord, and she is healed. By Jesus' stripes, we were healed. 1 Peter 2:24. Can we take another little side note? I'm almost done. I do believe that God puts beautiful things in nature for us to take delight in. Are you enjoying spring? The flowers? I have those little wild violets that are blooming in my yard. They are so beautiful. I mean, you look at that and you know there's a great creator. I have a rose bush. It's blooming. It's a thornless rose bush and it's yellow. Is it I forgot the name of it. It's a thornless rose bush and it mixed in it some blackberries and everything's blooming. It's just God puts things in the earth for us to delight in. And a friend of mine, her oldest daughter is not serving the Lord. The daughter was raised in church. She's like 21 now, and is not serving the Lord. It's been very heartbreaking for her. Her daughter's not wild and on drugs, but she's not in church. She doesn't really want a whole lot to do with Jesus. And so they're praying for her, and it's sad when your kids are not choosing the Lord. They see little breakthroughs at times. She'll come, but just still kind of distant, the daughter is. And so it's just a real special story. So she's been praying for her daughter and believing and loving her through it. And you know, you mean you're going to love them through it. You're going to loose them and let them go. You're going to try your best. And people don't want it. They don't want it. And so her daughter has the same birthday as my Samuel. And she gave her daughter a birthday card. And it was a real sweet card. And it talked about, go out today and enjoy butterflies, the flowers, and a pink rainbow because God put those things for you to take delight in. God really has put, when I pet my cat, I'm like, God gave me this cat. I take delight in his creation. I really do. Now, when they heard about the card and it said a pink rainbow, I've never seen a pink rainbow in my life. I've seen rainbows, not a pink rainbow. The next morning, a Sunday morning, she got up to go outside and there was literally a pink rainbow in the sky. They took a picture and sent it to me. God had really put a pink rainbow for that little girl to see. She's a woman, young woman. And she ran in the house and said, Mama, come here. And the sky was lit up. There was a rainbow and it was all pink and all the sky was pink. Ain't that something? God's always after the hearts of his. He wants them to be his children. People say everyone's God's children. No, they're not. They're not saved. They're not in the family. But he wants them to be. So he wanted her to take delight in that. He was showing his, I see God in nature. God's not nature. I just see his glory in his creation. So what are we going to loose people from? We're going to loose the sinner from their sins. Don't be shy to share your faith. If you got saved, you got a testimony to share. I was once in darkness, now I'm in the light. And you know why? Because of Jesus Christ. He died for me and he died for you. On April 13th, we're going to do the outreach. I bumped it. On April 13th, we're going to do the outreach. The community, the unity team's going to get together. We're going to meet here at 10 o'clock in the morning, and we're going to go into neighborhoods picking up trash. But it's just really an excuse to knock on doors and pray for people. And we got a bunch of soul-winning tracts from the little bookstore in Ruston. And if you don't know how to lead someone to Jesus, man, let us know. We need, probably the Wednesday before, we need to do some little get together here where we teach people how to seal the deal, so to speak, how to bring them into that point of they are a sinner. You don't want to condemn them, but you want to get them to understand that if they don't receive God's love and forgiveness, that they will go to hell. That is the truth. We can preach God's love all day long, and yes, that's part of it, is kindness leads us to repentance, but you got to let them know they're in need, and they need a Savior. And so we bought a bunch of those so we can put at doors if someone's not home. One of the ministers I like to listen to, Jonathan Shuttlesworth, his mom, when she was a teenager, was in a mall, and someone gave her a gospel tract. She went home, read it, and got saved. So we need to preach the gospel, absolutely. We don't need to neglect that and just hand out tracts. But we will in this situation, because not everyone's going to answer their door. Maybe not everyone's home. But let's go let some people go. Let's go loose the sinner and let them go. Let's go tell them God loves them. Let's invite them to church. Let's pray over them. You know, I think about my testimony. I was hungry for God. I wanted to change. I was like ripe fruit on a tree. I wanted something different. My life was bad. It was so easy to get me saved. How many people you think are out there right now just waiting for someone to tell them? But if we don't do our part, people will die and go to hell. I'm not trying to put a weight and responsibility on us, but I am at the same time. You know, when you read the New Testament, you see one time Jesus appeared to someone to get them saved, and that was the Apostle Paul. Every other time he expected, so that's not his usual way. He can do that, but his usual way is, tag, you're it, loose them and let them go. You go do it. It is the greatest joy when you lead somebody to Jesus. When you see the light turn on in their eyes and they cross over from spiritual death into life with the Lord. I'm so thankful you didn't give up on me. I'm so thankful for my salvation. And I just want to share that with others. Are y'all good tonight? We're about to end. Let's loose the sick from their diseases. You can take one healing scripture and go preach it to them. 1 Peter 2:24, by Jesus' stripes you were healed. So if you were healed, you are healed. Matthew 8:17, he took our infirmities and carried all our diseases. When the leper came to Jesus, he said, I am willing. Go back and watch the healing classes. Take notes. Go pray for someone who's sick. Teach them how to walk in their authority. Teach them how to stand in faith for that healing. Loose people bound by satanic influence. Before I got saved, there was satanic influence in my life. There was absolutely demonic control over my mind and me. Like, I would yield to bulimia, like I couldn't fight it. It was absolutely demonic. And when I got saved, that's why it was so easy to get set free. When the Lord spoke to me, you don't have to do this anymore. What he was saying was, you don't need to come into agreement with that demon. People are bound up mentally, satanic oppression. Loose them and let them go. Tell them there's freedom. Tell them God wants better for them. Amen? You were preaching in Cambodia, and a little boy went and vomited in our bathroom because that demon came out of him. He just heard the truth, and it set him free. We were preaching in our international church. Remember those two sisters from Bolivia? And one started manifesting a demon. She vomited everywhere, and it stinks. And I had to clean it. Yeah. We couldn't set her free, though. The sister freaked out and made her leave. She said, I've never seen her do this before. I'm like, yeah, it's a demon. She's convulsing. They wouldn't let us help her, though. They got scared. They left, which really was the Holy Spirit working. Let her get free. People have demonic. She didn't even know. She was carrying on something demonic, and they didn't even know. I wonder what it was. I didn't get a discerning thought. It could have been depression. It could have been who knows what it was. Something manifests in her under the anointing. Lose people that are bound by satanic influence. Let's set people free of religion. That's my last one. You know, I was brought up in a religion that taught more man-made rules and extra biblical teachings than this. So you can understand that would bring a lot of confusion. You don't know if you're going to heaven or hell. You don't know if you can do a bunch of works. You don't know if you're going to be in purgatory. You don't know if someone's going to pray your soul out. I mean, crazy. But no one had to come and say, hey, that's wrong, that's wrong, that's wrong, that's wrong. All you did was teach me the truth. You brought me to a church that taught me the truth, and it worked. Religion just fell off. It just falls off. When you give people the truth, you don't need to worry about telling them everything they believe is wrong. Just give them the truth. Religion will fall off. I remember one time I was thinking about praying a certain way that this religion teaches you to pray, which is not scriptural at all. You don't pray to saints and that they did not die for us. We pray to Jesus. I remember the Holy Spirit said, you don't have to do that. You have me. Jesus was saying, you have me. You just give people truth and religion will fall off. Don't give them what a denomination teaches. Don't give them human reasoning. Go to the Word of God. When we met, whenever you met Sampan, who is now pastoring our village churches in Cambodia, he was Buddhist. You led him to the Lord. And he'd have so many questions for Jeremy. I mean, you coming out of Buddhism into Christianity. Whole other God. Their God's fake. Whole other thought process. And he'd have so many questions. Jeremy would just give him the word. He'd give him the word. He'd give him the word and give him the word and give him the word. When people ask you, what's your opinion about something? Say, I don't have an opinion. Let's just go with the Bible says. They can't argue with that. Unless they don't believe this is the infallible word of God. Then if they don't believe this, then you can't go anywhere with them. So let's set people free from sin, diseases, satanic influence, and religion. Let's teach people to live in victory. Get them baptized in the Holy Spirit. Get them filled with joy. This is just a simple message tonight. Let's repeat this. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
We said that like we're not loose yet. Come on. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
I am loosed.
I am loosed.
From the bondage of poverty.
From the bondage of poverty.
I am loosed.
From the bondage
of sickness and disease.
I am loosed
from all bondage.
Because Jesus has set me free.
Now you loose them and let them go.
Yeah.
Amen. Come on. Thank you, Jesus. Seriously, on April 13th, you'll come meet us. If you're shy to share your faith, then you can just be one to pick up trash in the yard, because you're going to need two. You're going to need someone pretending like they're cleaning up so someone can knock on the door and pray. So we need everybody. You might just be the driver with the water, the ice chest with the water, and holding all the Bibles we're going to give out. So let's meet April 13th. Let's go loose some people and set them free. It's our part to play. There will be people who will not be set free unless the church stands up and does their part. Amen?
Amen?
Well, thank you, Jesus. We're all free. Does anyone need prayer for anything? Anybody need prayer? We just confess we're loose and set free, so I guess we are. Well, thank y'all for joining us tonight. Be blessed, and we will see y'all Sunday, and also for the Bible study on Sunday. Amen.